Well, this is going to be part two of chapter 9 for the version 5.0 on the NetAcad CCNA course 1 for the RNS course. My name is Jason Johnson. Thank you for watching this video. If you find any information on this video helpful and you want to be updated on future videos, just click the subscribe button below. If you have a question, you can leave a comment and I'll get back to you as quick as possible. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to finish up with part two of chapter 9 here, and we're going to primarily focus on variable link subnet mask. And what we mean by variable length is, let's go back and review the subnet mask quickly, or just for a few moments, so that we know what we're doing normally with the subnet mask. We are coming in and we are breaking up a subnet so that we can put a different amount of host onto a network. Let me back up here just a bit so we can see this. So when we break this subnet up, so we have a subnet broken up and we do the first net subnet, the second one, you know, and so forth. This one's 4, 5, 6, and 7. But we break those up and those are all the same length. Each one of them has the same amount of IP addresses available for use. So what happens is, let's say that we have a network that doesn't need to have, let's say 20 in each subnet. We have a, let's say a network that only needs two. Let's say that, let me show you an example here. Here we go. I'll show you this example right here. So this subnet right here only requires, and this is IPv6, so don't worry about IPv6 at this point. Just look, what we're looking here is at the actual subnet and how this is broken down. So let's just say that we need 20 here, 20 here, 20 here, and 20 here in these subnets. You know, these are, or let's just say these are subnets here. So I need 20 here and I need 20 here. But in here, I only need two IP addresses. So why would I assign 20 subnets, or not subnets, but 20 IP addresses into this subnet when I only need two of them? So we fix that by going into the variable length subnet mask process. So in this process, under our traditional subnetting, we use the same number of addresses in each subnet. So subnets that require fewer addresses are just wasted. We're never going to use those. So for example, if we have 30 hosts into a subnet and we only need two of those, 28 of those host IP addresses are just going to be wasted. We'll never use those, especially if we have those on two routers that are connected to each other. We're only going to need two host IP addresses and those will be wasted. So what we do is we break that up into variable length subnet mask. So we have varying sizes of subnets. And so we might have 30 here, 30 here, but we only need like maybe 8 here in each one of these, or maybe even 2, or we break those up into 8 of 2 subnets each. So we can have 8 of these, and each of these 8 only have 2, so then we can have multiple subnets here. We're going to have 8 subnets with 2 each. So how do we do that? We do that by breaking them up a little piece at a time, and we start at the top of the subnet net mass chart. And we start breaking those up, and we break those up by making the first, you know, we have our initial one, which is a /24 on our CIDR addressing. And then we break each one of those up. We give them a 27, a 27, 27 on down. And then we borrow 3 more bits, and then that gives us our WAN addresses. And so we can break those up even farther. And let me give you a link here to a good video on variable link subnet masking. Let me pause the video here, and you won't see it paused, but I'm going to put a link here for you. Okay, well, instead of putting the link on here, what I'm going to do is just in the comments, I'll put the link to the playlist for my subnetting playlist, which shows you how to subnet, and then I'm going to record a video on how to do a variable link subnet mask in there. But essentially what we're doing is we're breaking up the subnet into small. We start out with small subnets, or a small number. We subnet all the way to the right of however many numbers we need. And if you go and watch the video on how to do that, on how to actually practically do that, what we're doing is we're breaking those up so that we have small numbers of subnets that we borrowed from the bits there, so that we can not waste those. Waste those. So let's look at this here, and we'll get what we're meaning by this. So what we need is, when we configure this, we only need a slash 27 for the two IP addresses here. So when we do a slash 27, that gives us the number of host IP addresses that we need, and we're not wasting those numbers. So we do four subnets at slash 27 each. And as you can see the numbers here, the first one is 0. And then this one, our network ID is 32, network ID is 64, network ID is 96. And so that gives us a limited number of hosts, but we only need two per each one. And so that's what the variable link subnet mask does for us. And if you go watch the video on how to actually create a variable link subnet mask, you'll understand that a little bit better. So here's a chart here that shows you on how to break out. So we have building A, building B, C, and D. We're not using these, but our network IP address is 0. So our host is .1 to .30. And then this one is 32 to 62. This one is 64 to 94, or 95, excuse me. It's not showing us our broadcast out here, but we're assuming that our broadcast out here is 63. 31, because see our next one is 32. And if you watch my videos on how to do subnetting, you'll notice that. So what we're doing down here on our 224 is our network ID, and then 255 is our broadcast. But then we can break those up, and then we can do slash 30 down here. This is one where we use them off the bottom. Traditionally, what I've seen on the variable link subnet mask is we use the VLSM off the top, and then use the remainder at the bottom so that we can, you know, configure down. But what they've done here is they've used it off the bottom, and either way works. But what they're doing is at the end of it, they're doing a .224 for their network. So that gives them a .225, .226. The broadcast is .227. Broadcast ID is 227. So then our next range is .228. So we're using a slash 27 up here for these. We're using a slash 30 up here. And so a slash 30 gives us two usable hosts per subnet range, and we only need two per. And so we need three subnets with two each, and that's what that's giving us here. And then we have these down here that are unused, and those will be able to be used later. So hopefully you can see from this demonstration here how easy it is to subnet out for a variable length subnet mask. And this one, like I said, that we've used the bottom range for the numbers. I like using the top range and then leaving some gap in between. But this one, they're just using the bottom. So they're saying that they know if they have to add more routers in. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more subnets that we can add in of host of two per each host. So, you know, 33, 34. So we have two usable hosts. You know, that's our network. That's our broadcast out here. And that's how that's broken down. Let's take a quick look here at the addressing schemes that we set up. So the purpose of planning, and if you've taken any classes, any business classes with me or business process classes, you'll know that I put a huge emphasis on planning. You know, you can save yourself a lot of work just in planning. So you spend 5 hours planning. If you save yourself 10 hours of work, that 5 hours of planning was worth it. But if you go into a project, or you go in and you just start working on it, and you spend 10 hours on something that you could have saved 5 hours of planning, you know, spent 5 hours of planning, saved you 10 hours of work, that's a big cost benefit to you. So what we do with the planning process and the addressing or planning our network out, we prevent duplication of addresses. We provide and control access, and we monitor security and performance. So the client addresses are usually assigned using the DHCP or dynamic host control, or excuse me, dynamic host configuration protocol. For some reason, I want to call that control, but it's configuration protocol. That is what allows us to set a range of IP addresses and have those automatically handed out, so we don't have to do anything. Either the router is running a DHCP server, or we have some type of DHCP service setting inside of our network, and those are passing out those IP addresses. And so this is a sample network address plan. So we're going to say we need host devices We're going to do .1 to .229. We need servers. We know we're going to reserve at least 9 IP addresses for our servers, or 10 here, excuse me, from 230 to 239. Printers we need from 240 to 249. Intermediate devices, these are our connection, our routers, 250 to 253. And then our gateway LAN, they've used the high end. There are a couple of different thought processes here. I have heard some security people, or I've heard in the security area, that they will tell you don't make your gateway router the .1, because that makes it easier for hackers to guess what your IP address is. The counter argument that I make to that is if your network is available for someone to sniff traffic or be able to see the traffic, they're going to be able to easily see what that gateway IP address is. So it really doesn't matter if it's the .1 or if it's the .254. It's just not going to matter to someone that's actually scanning. Now, someone just trying to guess what your scheme is or guess what your network address plan is, yeah, that might throw them off a little bit if you put it in the middle. But I always just make my gateway LAN interface the .1. Just that way I know it's always there. But in this plan, they made it the .254. So when we look at IPv6 and we do our design considerations for that, IPv6, if you've researched any of the IPv6, it's a we have increased the length of our block of addresses because we are running out of addresses, or we have ran out of addresses for the IPv4. So we have created IPv6, or I say we, the networking world, the internet world, the computing world has created the IPv6 version, which gives us this length of IP addresses, and it's written in hexadecimal. So instead of being written in decimal format, dotted, hexade or not hexadecimal, excuse me, instead of it be written in octets, it's written in hexadecimal. And so our first range is our first 48 bits are our global routing prefix. Our subnet ID, and this is our sub where we subnet, is 16 bits long. And then our interface ID is 64 bits long. So our subnet is where we do our subnetting in a IPv6, or I'm just going to call it a V6, is your 16 bits long. But we have 65,536 subnets available to us in there. And then our interface ID is 64 bits long. And so how we do that is we increment our subnet ID to create 65,536 subnets. We have our first part here, our first 48 bits. Then we have our subnet ID, and then we have our interface ID. So this is a slash, what we call a slash 48. And in another video, your other videos, you're going to see the IPv6 and how you can, condense it. So like dot dot is going to let you know that that's zeros all in there at the end part. But this is breaking down, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then each one of those, the increments on there. So when we allocate our V6, our first subnet is going to be 0001. That's going to give us our five subnets allocated from the 65,000 available subnets. Now, that's not 65,000 host IP addresses. That's 65,536 subnets. Just so you see the size of this, that's not IP addresses available. That's subnets available. Just so you understand the concept that how large that is. So we have five subnets. We've reserved our zero. We started off with our 01, 02, 03, 04, 05. And then so we've given each one of these subnets here, subnet there. We've used a 003 there. 04, 02, 05. And now we've got those broken down. So when we talk about a nibble, V6 bits can be borrowed from the interface ID to create additional IPv6 subnets if you need those. And these are going to be in large networks, but if you need those, a nibble is 4 bits. That's one hexadecimal digit. And so you borrow one nibble. So you go over and borrow one hexadecimal digit, which is 4 bits. which in the V4 world, if you borrow one place, that's going to be, you know, one bit. But here we're borrowing 4 bits in the hexadecimal. So you can borrow over into the interface ID area if you need more subnets. Okay, well, as a summary, what we have looked at in Chapter 9 is the subnetting process. You can check out my subnet videos over on the playlist. I'll put a link in the description below. And you typically are going to do just a basic subnetting with your V4. As we move into the V6 world, you're going to start using a V6 to subnet. And the different sizes of your networks, and whether you use a regular subnetting or VLSM. We really go away from VLSM when we get into the V6. But you need to, when you plan out your network, you need to look at the size, the location, your requirements, growth planning. If you need to plan into your network, you need to put into your network plan any type of growth that you may have. So you don't want to just restrict yourself to say, oh, wait, I'm going to add 3 more routers in a year's time. Well, you don't know what's going to happen. We really don't know what's going to happen in a year's time or 5 years' time, but we try to plan as best as possible for growth. And so you leave yourself some planning availability on that. And then IP networks must be tested to verify connectivity and operational performance. Okay, so that's the end of this video as I finish up Chapter 9 here. If you have any questions on this, you can leave a comment below, and I'll get back to you as quick as possible. And this was the NETACAD CCNA Course 1 Version 5 for Chapter 9, Part 2.